I'm traveling back in time to when cowboys ruled the prairie.
Yeehaw!
When buffaloes roamed the plains. And when steam trains ran America.
Loving it!
This is the hardest working steam locomotive in the USA.
They don't make them like this anymore, baby.
This is living, breathing history right here today.
My name is Matt Baum. Ever since I was a kid, I've been obsessed with trains. My day job? I work on a railroad in Maine. But this is my dream. To ride the biggest, fastest, most awesome trains in history.
Is the Union Pacific 844, the finest steam locomotive ever built.
It's been pulling passengers and freight across the country since 1944. In fact, it's the longest running steam locomotive in America. Now it's gonna take 750 passengers on the ride of their lives.
Picking them up in Denver and bringing them here to the magic city of the plains, Cheyenne, Wyoming.
To see this.
The biggest rodeo in the world.
It's the most prized ticket in American railroading.
All aboard!
And I've got a VIP pass. It's a 100-mile straight shot from Cheyenne down to Denver's Union Station. There, we'll turn the train around, collect the rail fans, and bring them back to Cheyenne for the rodeo.
Most people think that the age of steam railroading is dead, but not here in Cheyenne. This is home to the largest working steam locomotive shop in America. The UP Steam Shop.
Here, a dedicated team of workers are busy getting the 844 ready for her big day. And this gigantic locomotive needs a lot of attention.
From one end to the other, it's 114 feet, and it weighs over 450 tons.
That's the same weight as a jumbo jet. We're talking a lot of locomotive.
Starting this giant locomotive is like waking a sleeping dragon.
And that's something you want to do very carefully.
If they heat this locomotive up too fast, the metal's going to expand, rivets are going to shoot out. It's gonna cause all kinds of damage. So what they do is, they take warm steam, they pump it through this hose into the boiler and warm it up slowly.
It's like warming your car on a cold winter's morning, but a lot more dangerous.
The temperature of this steam is nearly 400 degrees. That's enough to melt the skin right off your face. So Ed here wants to make sure this hose is on tight.
Now we need to fire up the steam generator.
Let's go check it out. This over here is the steam generator. Right here. What it boils down to, it's just like a giant teapot. Makes steam. Once the steam is created, it goes through that white pipe over there, over to the engine. Let's make some steam.
Ed, is it all right if I press the button?
You bet.
All right. Oh, my hand.
If I open this valve up, the 844 is gonna come to life. That pipe, see it? It's feeding the steam to our locomotive right here. And you can feel it. This pipe is boiling hot. It's kind of like the first day of winter when the central heating system in your house warms up, you hear it popping and creaking. What's going on right here is this beast is waking up. Ow! It takes skill, craftsmanship, and patience to work on these giants.
But the basic principles of a steam engine are pretty simple. Here's how it works. Fuel is burnt in the firebox to create heat. The heat turns water into steam. As the steam expands, it's forced through a series of pipes into a set of pistons. The pressure of the steam drives the pistons. That's what makes the wheels go round. For the Union Pacific Steam Team, caring for the 844 is more than just a job. It's a labor of love.
You gotta make her happy. She's a living, breathing creature. She's alive!
Yep, you gotta treat her right.
This locomotive is about ready to go out on the road. But because it doesn't have any fuel in it yet, it has to be pulled out of the shop using an engine called the yard goat.
It's only about 1,200 horsepower. Doesn't sound like much, but this baby's made to pull.
We're gonna go in and hook onto the 844. We're gonna drag it out, fire it up.
There's the
horn. Clint, how do you feel when you bring that big beast out like that?
Get pretty used to it, but
still, I mean, come
it's
on.
Nice to get it out in the sunlight.
Yeah.
It doesn't really belong in a building.
And there she is in all her glory out in the sunlight. It's beautiful.
The 844 was originally built to run on coal, but that was too expensive. So now, it runs on recycled engine oil.
The oil comes in this truck right here, and it's some nasty stuff.
The oil is pumped into a giant tank that sits behind the locomotive called a tender.
This tender can hold 6,500 gallons of oil. If you're gonna do that at the gas pump, it costs you $26,000. This is the fuel hose. It's gonna plug into that tank right there.
Shut off and all.
Okay.
Bam, it's hooked up, ready to start pumping some oil.
The oil comes from the truck down there. It's pumped up this hose, goes right into here and down into the tank. You can see it in there, it's filling up. All right, show us the dipstick. Wow, look at that dipstick. Oh, wow.
It's getting up there now.
75 inches full.
It's like a dipstick for your car, except it's about 8 feet long.
6,500 gallons of oil might sound like a lot, but this engine sure can drink.
For every mile, the 844 burns 15 to 25 gallons of this fuel right here. That's one of the reasons they had to get rid of these locomotives, because they're not very efficient.
But filling up with fuel is only half the job. It's not called a steam locomotive for nothing. This locomotive needs water.
If you don't have water, you don't have steam. That's the water going into this tank right here, 28,000 gallons. It's gonna make the steam.
To stop the engine from getting clogged with lime scale, they add a special chemical to the water. Lime scale is caused by a mineral called calcium carbonate. Above 70 degrees, it forms deposits that can clog the boiler pipes with gunk, and the whole thing could explode. The 844 is loaded with fuel and water. It's time to fire it up.
We like fire. This could be dangerous. Ed has on protective gear, could flash back, and it wouldn't be pretty.
Okay, we're gonna take this oily rag here.
We're gonna set it right on the firebox. We're gonna take this fusee, which is a flare, light it up, light the rag up, throw the rag into the firebox, and blam, fire.
What's happening now is the oil is slowly being fed into the firebox, and it's very, very hot. It's gotta be a couple of thousand degrees. My gloves feel like they're catching on fire right now. Woo! Looks kind of quiet right now, but soon this is gonna be hauling more than a half mile worth of passenger coaches behind it. It's gonna be going up to 70 miles an hour. It's gonna be freaking awesome, man. This is the Magic City of the Plains, Cheyenne, Wyoming. Over the next few days, over 300,000 people are gonna be arriving here in Cheyenne.
And they're coming to see one thing.
The biggest rodeo in the world. And a select few will be coming in on a very special train.
This is the Union Pacific number 844. The 844 was the last steam locomotive to be built for the Union Pacific Railroad. When it left the factory in 1944, it was the pinnacle of modern engineering.
The 844 was built for speed. On the flats, it could pull 26 passenger cars over 100 miles an hour. It could make the trip from Cheyenne to Salt Lake in just 10 hours.
Today, it's going from the Union Pacific Yard in Cheyenne, 100 miles south to Denver, to collect 750 rail fans and bring them back to Cheyenne for the rodeo.
I've always wanted to ride one of these classic steam locomotives, and now I'm gonna get the chance.
But before we can go anywhere, we need to get this 450-ton locomotive on the right track. That's where the turntable comes in. It's like a giant Lazy Susan, but for trains.
So they can spin the engine around, put it anywhere they want.
Here's how it works. A locomotive rolls off one set of tracks onto the turntable. The table spins and lines up with a new set of tracks, and the locomotive rolls off again.
There's been a turntable here since the 1860s. This one can hold 800 tons on it. It's powered by electricity. Back in the day, they powered it by compressed air. Even before that, they powered it with pure manpower.
First, we have to lock the tracks. If the table moves while the locomotive is rolling on, it could derail.
Locks it up. Now you can bring a locomotive off the turntable, right to this track, right there. That thing is huge. It barely fits on this turntable. Look at it.
Once the locomotive is on the turntable, the tracks are unlocked. And with the pull of a lever, I'm spinning a 450-ton piece of railroading history.
Spinning the 844, what an honor, man! All right, now it's facing towards Denver. Let's go get the coaches.
We're gonna hook the 844 onto 26 of America's finest vintage rail cars.
The problem is that a lot of them are close to 60 years old. You have to be very delicate. You can't slam them around like freight cars.
For the crew, the pressure is on. One mistake and a piece of railroad history could be damaged forever. Here's how they do it.
This is Ed. He's the engineer. He controls this beast. All these levers, all these controls, the whistle, it's his job to drive this. He runs the locomotive.
The radio communications they have on the 844 isn't something they would have had back in the 1940s. Back then, they would have used hand signals and whistles.
1-2, we're standing still. 2-2s, we're going ahead. 3-2s, we're backing up. A succession of short toots like toot, 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 toot. Means get the heck off the tracks. Here comes the 844. Sucker.
Train cars are connected by a device called a coupler. When two couplers hit, they should hook up automatically.
All right, we're backing up. We're gonna make the hook. We don't want to make a hard one. We don't want to damage those passenger coaches. They're some of the oldest in America. The hook didn't make.
Okay, that'll be good enough, and then bang into him.
He's gonna slam back into the hook, nice. Well, he wasn't just gonna slam, he's gonna do it nice and easy. There's the hook. We made it. We're about ready to go. Denver, here we come. The noises are amazing. It's so many different sounds. There's the chuffing, the floor's shaking, there's thumping. I'm riding a living, breathing piece of history right here.
We'll be right back. 844 first rolled out of the factory in the 1940s, it pulled high-speed passenger trains. But when diesel locomotives took over in the 1950s, Union Pacific decided steam engines were too expensive to maintain. In 1959, they stopped commercial steam operations altogether. The 844 was sent to Omaha to work in a yard melting snow off the tracks. By 1960, it was the only steam engine left in operation and was set aside for special occasions, like trips to the rodeo. The 844 is halfway to Denver, and we've changed crews. Everyone wants a turn at running a piece of history.
I know from running a modern diesel locomotive, it's pretty simple. You just pull the throttle out and go. Up here in the 844, it's a lot different. There's a lot more going on. All right, let's introduce you to the... crew. Get Cameron over here. He's the fireman. It's his job to make the steam. Get Steve. That's the engineer. He's running the engine. The more steam the engineer uses, the more the fireman has to keep making it.
If the fireman lets the fire go out, the train will literally run out of steam and grind to a halt.
Cameron here decides how much oil he wants to feed to the fire. He's looking at what Steve's doing over there with the throttle. Depending on the throttle position, that's going to decide how much steam the engine is using.
But running out of steam isn't the worst thing that can happen.
The most dangerous thing that can happen on a steam locomotive is to run out of water. And the boiler in front of us is about 10 miles of pipes. There's not enough water in those pipes. It's going to get really, really hot. Eventually, it's going to explode.
The history of steam locomotives is littered with boiler explosions. February 1911, Smithville, Texas. The boiler on a yard engine blows up. Four men lose their lives and 12 are injured. March 1912, San Antonio, Texas. 26 people are killed when a Southern Pacific locomotive explodes. December 1934, Fayette County, West Virginia. A locomotive hauling mine workers blows up, killing 18. It's up to the firemen to keep track of how much water is going into the boiler.
Right there's the water glass. That's what the fireman has to watch to make sure there's enough water in the boiler. You see it bobbing down up in there. He's got to keep a keen eye on that. Very important part of his job.
There's no reserve tank. If the fireman gets the water level wrong, it could be fatal.
If there's not enough, the boiler's going to explode. Boom!
I'm heading to Denver to pick up a posse of rail fans and take them to the world's biggest rodeo in Cheyenne, Wyoming.
Goodbye, Wyoming. Hello, Colorado.
It might look pretty, but I've got to tell you, this is one of the scariest trains I've ever ridden because we're doing 60 miles an hour and I can't see where we're going. Modern locomotives have windows at the front, so the engineer and conductor can see what's up ahead.
If you want to look at a signal, just look out the window. It's right there in front of you. On this locomotive, the whole locomotive is in front of you, so you got to stick your head out that window.
That's not a problem on a straight track, but on a left-hand curve, the engineer can't see anything.
Steve, this is a huge locomotive. So how far can you see ahead with this big locomotive in front of you?
If you're going around a curve, you can't see anything to the left.
Steve's going to be blind if we're going around a curve this way.
So if there's a red signal or another train,